And we have 50 here so far.
Okay, so we're recording now.
Okay, well, let me. And so it's a good idea to mute yourself when you're not talking. Katie Beck is here. Hi.
Maybe arrived.
Oh, he was here from the beginning, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well.
Have you muted?
So, welcome to Bloomington Rotary Club's weekly celebration of service for May 12th. I'm the current club president, Aaron Davis, and it's just great to have you all here, including our special guests. Wherever you are, thanks for being here. And now I'd like Tim Jessen to lead the pledge and then introduce our special guest for reflection. Tim.
You're muted.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America
and to the Republic
for which it stands, one nation under God,
indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all. I followed the method that one of our members suggested about a year or so ago. No comma between nation and under God. Nobody ever follows it, but that's what I tried to do. But it's a very appropriate message for the person I'm going to introduce, Siobhan Mighty, who is a member, a very outstanding member of the Muslim community here in Bloomington, has been the past president of the mosque, and currently is serving as an active member there and dealing with the implications of the coronavirus for members of the Muslim community. So I asked him after talking with Aaron to speak a little bit about how this has affected the celebration of Ramadan in the Islamic community. Siobhan, it's your turn now.
Thank you, Tim. I've known Tim for a while now, and I always appreciate the things that he gets me into. So I hope that I don't mess up the format of your of the reflections for the Rotary Club. I'm impressed to see how many people are here today. I'm just going to, I guess, speak a couple of words about Ramadan and what it means to the Muslims and how it's affecting us, how this pandemic, how this crisis is affecting us. For Muslims, Ramadan is a time of reverence to the God of Abraham, the same God that we believe that we worship together with the Jews, with the Christians. And I recognize that this is also a time that's very, it's very challenging for religious communities in all sorts of different parts of the world. For example, as my mother, who I believe is here in this meeting, I didn't know she was going to be here. She herself is a Methodist, and Easter was, it was, you know, this was during Easter. And if I understand correctly, it was also during Passover. So I don't want to say that Muslims are the only ones who are affected and how this, and how it affects very holy times of the year. But I think what that means though, is that we understand Muslims and Christians and Jewish members of our community all understand the same plight. We understand the same challenges and difficulty where we ordinarily would have this as a time of community and prayer, but it's been kind of uprooted and it's forcing us to think differently. Ramadan is a time where Muslims fast every day. No food, no drink, no water, no intimate relations with spouses, and also just no partaking in other kinds of sins, no backbiting, lying. And this is a time where Muslims also gather. We meet together to break the fast every night at sunset. And it's, even though we have a small community here in Bloomington, it's incredible the amount of work that the Muslims put to celebrate Ramadan, to celebrate together, a time of community where there's over 100 Muslims every single night would go to the mosque, bring food. And it was a time of celebration where we would have an Egyptian night where the Egyptians would bring food. And then we would have a Pakistani night, and it would almost be competing who can bring, you know, the most food and be the most generous to the community. And we all got to talk together and hug and pray. And every night we would pray for an hour together. This is called Taraweeh, where Muslims pray side by side for a whole hour, where at each of the 30 nights of the month, because there's 30 days, approximately 29 or 30 days, depending on the lunar cycle, we would pray for an hour. And each day we would pray, we would recite a 30th of the Quran, the holy book of Muslims. And so in this, so there was a time of piety, a time of reflection. And for a lot of us, this has been a big challenge. However, this is also an interesting time because with the whole pandemic, it's actually brought us closer together in a lot of ways. Even though we're not physically close together, we are able to be close together in other ways. In other years, we've had some problems with continuity, with connection because of certain political differences. For example, as you might see in my background, there's the sliver of the moon. You can see the crescent moon. This is a photograph of the first photograph that was brought forward for the sighting of the moon in California, which heralds the start of the month. When you see the new moon, you see the crescent, that starts Ramadan. That's the start of Ramadan. And there's often a lot of fighting associated with that. There's, wait, hold on, should you sight the moon in Bloomington? What, California's too far away? Or what, why are we even sighting the moon anymore? Why don't we just, you know, pick a day that is astronomically most likely we'll sight it anyways, and then just go with it? You know, and so there's a lot of fighting associated with the moon sighting. But this year was surprisingly quiet on that front. No one seemed to have any energy to fight about whether or not the moon was sighted, partially because we didn't have to worry about deciding what the first day was to fast or to break the fast of the mosque, because we were all doing so in our own homes. So that was a nice change. But in addition, there'd be, you know, political differences. People would sometimes fight about politics or about our differences. But I think right now is a lot of us understand that we're all fighting the same thing together. In fact, this is I've lived a relatively short life compared to a number of you so far, but I don't remember a time where the Americans agreed together. I don't know. I'm sure that it's happened before, but I haven't personally witnessed it, where everyone seems to be fighting the same thing together. And especially in an election year, it's astonishing. And I think it brings us closer together, much like a sports team that has the same opponent. But there's other interesting things that have happened, because not all Muslims have been able to celebrate Ramadan together as we have been able to now. A lot of Muslims are held at home because they've got children or because they're sick and they can't come to the mosque. But we have this weekly sermon that we're able to do over Zoom. And so a lot of those who weren't able to come are now able to be together and be able to celebrate and have halaqas, which are reflections over the Quran and so on. That's new. Also, there's a lot of us who are having trouble in our community, some who are sick, some who can't go out. And so the Muslim community has created this community emergency response team, where it's a database of volunteers who run out and get groceries and get supplies for anyone who requests them. In fact, just a couple days ago, a woman who was tested for the coronavirus is under quarantine, and she said she needed something. And within 2 minutes of her making the request, someone said, "I'll do it." And they were able to go out to Blooming Foods, go out to Aldi, get a huge order. And this is something that we get to see, we get to manifest, materialize the things that we talk about. So Ramadan is a time for us to actually take action, not just talk about action. And it's so refreshing to be able to see us be the Muslims that we say we are without just, you know, letting this be a time of gluttony, a time of let's eat as much as we can after the sunset, but actually feel what it means to be a Muslim. I'll wrap up. I know that I don't want to take too much more time, but for me personally, this has been an interesting time because I have 4 children myself. And each night of Ramadan, I would go to the mosque in the sunsets are around 9 o'clock, right? So the children are already asleep. They're already in bed. They don't really see me fasting as much. It's not something that's really so much a part of their lives. They just know that Papa goes to the mosque at sunset, at bedtime, and they're not really part of it. But something that's been really interesting is that this coronavirus has forced us to bring Ramadan into our own houses. Before, Ramadan was mostly kind of a mosque activity where people would go to the mosque, but now we're forced to bring that mosque into our houses. So I don't know if this is the same for others, but our houses have now become the place of worship, have been the mosque, the church, the synagogue. And because of that, the children are able to now be part of it. My children, my oldest is 7, my second oldest is 5, and the second oldest has been fasting from 5 to sunset every day. The oldest has been intermittently fasting from around noon until sunset every day. And we all break the fast together. We eat a date together. We pray together. We eat at the same table together. And this has just brought families closer together. And I can't be grateful enough for what this has provided us and the reflection that we're forced to have. The pieces are all over the floor, but we're able at this time to see the pieces from a distance and pick up the pieces together in a way that reflects what's actually important to us and our priorities. And in the Quran, I'll just finish to say that in the Quran, there's a verse that says, "Inna ma'al usri yusra, inna ma'al usri yusra," which is to say that whenever there's hardship, there's also ease. Whenever there is hardship, there's also ease. So it's easy to see the hardship, but even when there's hardship in all of our religious traditions, it's upon us to see the blessings that have been provided to us and to make the best of what we have. That's what I have to say.
Thank you. Thank you, Siobhan. Thank you. Ramadan Mubarak.
Oh, thank you. Ramadan Mubarak. Yes. Thank you. It means blessed Ramadan to you.
And so I just wanted to acknowledge, I mean, thank you, Siobhan, and family members for being here. You're always welcome. So just want you to know that.
Well, I appreciate it.
Okay. Yes, I'd like you to acknowledge today's greeters, Jim Bright, Michael Shermis, Ashley Sullivan, and Katie Beck. And the boss man, Alan Barker. roundabout reporter for May is Glenda Murray. And thank you, Alan, for the use of this Zoom account and your expertise. Now we'd like to finish introducing guests who haven't fully been introduced yet. Jim Bright, who do we have that you're aware of?
Aaron, I see 2 visiting Rotarians out there. First of all, Mark Babs, who's president-elect of the Bloomfield Rotary Club. Welcome, Mark. And also, we're pleased to have back with us for the second week in a row here, former Bloomington Rotarian, now at North Carolina, Chapel Hill. Say hello to Dr. Raj Hadawi.
Hey.
Anybody else out there that I missed?
Hey Mark, is there anyone else from your club here?
I do not see anybody else. I guess they weren't able to make it. We had 3 or 4 that were going to attend, and I know 2 of them something came up. But
right. You're welcome to come again.
Hey, well, Mark, I'm here.
Oh, Kelly. Hello.
Where's Kelly at?
All right.
Well, Kelly is here then. Kelly, I'm sorry, really? Kelly.
Welcome. That's okay. I snuck in.
And anyone else that hasn't been recognized yet? We don't want to ignore you. Peggy Frisbee's here, Clint Ball. Okay. Katie and Ashley, anyone that you noticed that hasn't been recognized?
I think we got everyone.
Okay. Excuse me for those that I miss. It's a little hard to scroll over these screens. What's next coming up? I want to greet those who have signed in via phone or internet without video also. We may not see you, but your engagement is very much appreciated. So, welcome everyone to Rotary in Bloomington. Our Rotary family, we have a birthday this week. I don't think Heather Bozarth is here, but her birthday is tomorrow on the 13th. And we have membership anniversaries. Alan Barker, 6 years. Can you believe that, Alan? Thank you. And Dave Meyer, also 6 years. And then Natalie Blaze, two, huh? This is wonderful. It's so wonderful to have you. I remember those early days, Mike Baker and Sarah. It's so good to have you with us, Natalie. And for Rotarians in the news, we're always in the news. Yesterday, the HT included coverage of our high school scholarships. And that was a great really great article. Thank you, Jim Bright, for being our publicist and so much more. I don't know if you all know yet, but Matt Stitzinger he and his wife had their baby. He and Holly Stitzinger gave birth to their son, Hayes Matthew Stitzinger, and Hayes weighed 9 pounds, 2 ounces, and measured 21 3/4 inches long. So congratulations to Matt and Holly. And now, Mike Baker is going to give a little annual report from the Bloomington Rotary Foundation to our club.
Welcome, everybody. This is something we try to do every year. To give everybody an update just on the Bloomington Rotary Foundation. As most of you probably know, it's our local foundation for our club to do things in our community, as opposed to the Rotary Foundation, which does things internationally. Also in our community, but it's more focused on international. So the money that goes into this account comes from things like the toast. It comes into people that may donate the 80-20 or designate specific funds to the Bloomington Rotary Foundation. On our board is myself as president, Lauren Snyder, vice president, Kyle Cox Deckard as treasurer, Jerry Padgett this year, Leslie Green, Craig Spence, Joy Harder, and Glenn Inman was on the board, and I think he's stepped down from our club, so that's why we had another replacement. People this year that will be stepping down will be Leslie Green and Jerry Padgett, and they'll be stepping in, and of course Glenn is off of it, but they'll be stepping down the 1st of July. And I'm happy to announce that from the election, people that we proposed to join our board were unanimously voted for, and joining us starting the 1st of July will be Jim Capshue, Katie Beck, and Gil Souza, and then Sarah Laughlin will be coming on as secretary. Even though Natalie is officially our secretary for the foundation, since she is not an official club member, according to the bylaws, we need to have a secretary, a treasurer, a president, vice president. Okay, quickly, to date, roughly we have around $56,599 in checking and savings. That may vary a little bit based on when I got the last report. Of that was around 11,600 of the toast money from last year that is sitting there to be used on some of our local service projects, and hopefully some of the matches that we'll be able to use with Rotary International. We also use the foundation to help the other two Bloomington clubs. So we're holding money for the North Club and Sunrise, also their toast funds. We have just a little over $4,600 in savings. And we have an account at the Community Foundation worth $32,887. We get an annual disbursement from them from the investment of these funds. And we're trying to also build a fund to support scholarships. So our unrestricted net assets are around $32,000. And again, our total liability and equity is around $90,000. We cannot use funds in the foundation for club, normal club functions. However, we got a formal request from our club this year to be able to use some of the funds from the foundation to help support the scholarships. So we made an initial disbursement of $1,500 to our club to help them support the scholarships at Ivy Tech. And then we had another request to see if we could use funds to help, again, support the scholarship program this year, which is normally $6,000 in the club's budget. But our board approved another $3,000 disbursement that will go towards the scholarships, which in effect eases some of the financial stress on the our club. So there's a way to use some of the money that does benefit us as a club. Other than that, I'm trying to think if there's anything else. That I have on my notes. If there's any questions about that, you know, you can ask me or email me later. And then at the end of this meeting, there'll just be a very short, maybe 5 or 10 minute meeting with the members of the Bloomington Rotary Foundation. There's a couple questions I need to ask related to some issues that we need to deal with. And other than that, if there's any questions, please ask. If not, thank you.
Thank you. Good word.
Thank you for your leadership, Mike, and for your helping in the club. I mean, the foundation is serving the same community and the same the same club, and you're a really important part of us. So thank you. Any questions?
I have a question. Has any community organization approached Rotary asking for support in any of the local initiatives to keep people, help people survive?
We did make a $1,369, I believe that was it, close to that, a disbursement from the foundation to help support the local mask making. But other than that, no, we've not had any other requests personally from any groups in the community.
Well, we don't open a request for proposals. We're not soliciting.
Right.
But Aaron, I could add something.
Please.
I don't think Ann Connors is not here, but we did receive 7 proposals for the district grant funding. All 7 of them would have been good investments. It's always a hard choice, but we chose the United Way's backpack literacy project. Right. And so the more to come on that. We have to submit the proposal, I think, by June 1st. They extended the deadline a month, and we will probably hear about the money in early August. And then at some point when it's safe to gather again, the volunteer opportunity will be to help fill those backpacks.
Yes.
600 of them, as I understand.
Yeah.
Mike, I wonder if you could clarify that. You said in the beginning that we're not supposed to use this for our own club, and yet we do. So try and explain.
Well, if it can be used for nonprofit organizations, charitable organizations, which the mask making was, and part of the focus of our foundation is to support scholarships. So inadvertently was the club benefited that we were able to give some money to the club to specifically use on scholarships? Yes. But that it fits the guidelines of our of the foundation, which is to support scholarships just as well as the service projects that Ann was talking about. But okay. if for example, the club said, you know, we need money to buy a banner for Ashley's year, or we need, you know, something of more of a business nature, then that doesn't fit the criteria of the foundation.
Right. Okay, I'd like to move to Happy Dollars now. We're running a little bit late. Anyone happy about anything?
My wife wanted me to put in a Happy Dollar from a, I think it's a possum named Petunia. And this was made by Martha Forster. So Connie wants to acknowledge that and put in a dollar. So thank you.
Thank you, guys.
I have one. This is more of an FYI, but pretty cool. German American has a new region president. We haven't had one for 6 months. And most of you probably know Cindy Canarney, who was the region president at First Financial. May 20th will be German American's new region president. We're looking forward to having her.
Congratulations.
I haven't had the news yet, so I thought I'd share with you all. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
I'll quickly jump in to mention that we have the Bloomington Early Music Festival live online is now going to be announced today, and it's going to go from 17th to the 24th. So I'll be in touch with information about that for everybody.
Wonderful. Are you
excellent?
And you'll provide
that for the roundabout.
Right, I'll provide a link to this one page description of everything that's going to be available. It's online at 7 p.m. from this coming Sunday through next Saturday.
Wonderful, thank you. Are you also doing the Jacobs School front row thing?
Oh, the Jacobs Connect? I'm not involved in that.
Oh, okay.
Okay, anyone else happy? We need to move on. Okay. Well, with that, I will introduce Michael Shermis, who will introduce two just amazingly special, wonderful speakers today.
Thanks, Aaron. Our program today, we get the pleasure of hearing from a couple of our very own members and their professional journeys. I'll make the introduction short and sweet, since that's what they're talking about is themselves, so no reason for me to dwell on that. I will say that I know them both prior to Rotary, and they're just good people. Met Tina while working as a consultant for PALS when she joined that board, and Jim I've just known for years around the community, and had a good fortune to be connected with him more lately. So with that, how about I turn it over to Tina first and let her talk about her professional journey.
Okay, can you hear me at this point? Yeah, okay. Well, most everybody knows that I'm a veterinarian here in town, and that journey started when I was very little. I always had a special fascination with animals, especially dogs, cats, and horses. And to the point that I remember getting coloring books and flipping through and coloring the horse pictures first before I went to anything else. Just always very connected, although my parents only allowed us to have a cat when I was growing up. So I was limited in the number of pets that we had at home. When I was 11, they did allow me to take riding lessons, and that opened a door where through high school, I probably spent more waking hours out at the barn than I did anywhere else. A lot of people think that I probably grew up on a barn, but I tell them, no, I was the kid that wished I grew up on a farm. So that was sort of my early experience with animals. And so I didn't think about going to vet school until I was a junior in high school, and my dad had the what are you going to do when you graduate from high school talk. And so I thought, well, it was kind of foregone that I would go to college, and thought, well, I was good in math, I liked science, and I loved animals. So it was then that I decided that I would try to go to vet school, and went to Purdue for pre-vet. You can be in pre-vet for 2 years, and at that time you could apply to vet school after 2 years if you had all your prerequisites in. And I applied, but I didn't get in that year. They told me I needed more experience. And so then I went home that summer and volunteered at a vet clinic. And then when I went back to Purdue, I started volunteering, which worked into a job in the animal disease diagnostic lab, which was really an interesting job that I had there. So the next time I applied to vet school, I did get in and finished off a bachelor's while I was in vet school because the credits came out right. And then graduated with my doctorate of veterinary medicine in 1981. And at that time, I was interested in going into mixed animal practice, but again, mostly dogs, cats, and horses. That's first year out, I didn't quite accomplish that. I did get a job as a small animal vet in Anderson, Indiana. But on my days off, I volunteered with a large animal vet who was in need of a heart valve transplant. And so he didn't have the energy to do things. So I was the person that hauled everything around, but I got a lot of good experience hanging out with him. And then after a year, I ended up here in Bloomington in a mixed animal practice, which I worked at for a couple of years. And then that was when College Mall Veterinary Hospital had been acquired by these people. And they, after 2 years, they decided that they didn't want to own it any longer. And they looked at me and said, and you're the likely candidate to buy it. So I, being young and naive and thinking what could go wrong, thought, sure, I'll buy the veterinary clinic. So that was the beginning of my professional journey in owning a veterinary clinic. And at first I was by myself, and over the, I think it was 31 years that I actually owned it, I built it up slowly to a six vet practice. But at the time that I purchased it, I was doing mixed animal practice, and I had to make a decision whether I was going to try to do that or just specialize in small animal. And I decided to go all small animal and keep horses as a hobby because I would be by myself. I felt it was going to be hard to be out on the farm when farmers needed me, when I also needed to be in the clinic when I had appointments with small animals. So I decided to just go the small animal route at that point and just keep my horses as a hobby. Over the years, I spent 8 years actually during that period of time also working with IU part-time. I was the attending vet there for their lab animal program, which grew and eventually needed somebody who would be full-time there. But that was an interesting sort of sideline that I did for a while. And then, trying to look at my notes, back in 2015, I decided that it was time to think about an exit strategy from owning the veterinary clinic. So I did sell the practice, but with the understanding that I would continue to work as a vet. And in fact, for 5 years, I was managing vet here. And just recently in the last year, I've given up the managing role and just, I'm an associate vet Still doing dogs and cats mainly, and small animal practice. And just that brings me up to current. I don't know if anybody has any questions about that.
Yeah, there's one one in the chat from Liz Feidel. What kind of horses do you have, team?
Right now, I have an American saddlebred horse. That was when I, in high school, was when I actually became an owner. In middle school, at the riding school that I was taking lessons at, I started working there to be able to take more lessons. And then in high school, my parents bought an American saddlebred horse for me. So that's where I got kind of my start, was with that breed, and ended up working with the trainer there and showing my horse and showing a lot of other horses. When I was in vet school, there was a period of time where I didn't have any horses because I was so busy. And then I got interested in dressage and doing eventing. I never got very, very good at it. I tell people that I was going for the Lifetime Achievement Award in beginner novice with that, but I owned a thoroughbred at that point. I owned an Appaloosa, and I now have an American saddlebred again. But I'm not into showing him in the American saddlebred shows that I did in my youth.
Great. And then there's another question that from Leslie Green about, tell us about your girls and what are they up to these days?
Oh, well, they both graduated. One, Jackie, graduated from IU with a secondary education degree in mathematics and a counseling minor. And then Jackie just graduated from University of Indianapolis with an exercise science degree, but she's been accepted into the program at IUPUI for physical therapy. So she's got a few more years left to go. And they did not get the horse bug that I grew up with. It skips generations, I think. So they have enjoyed being around, you know, the horses that I've had. They've even learned to ride, but they weren't ever horse crazy like I was.
And then I'll ask one question, and then we probably ought to move on to Jim. Can you say something about your involvement with PALS at all, since that's a cause that's dear to Rotary? So.
Well, it's, yes, for many, many years, it was near and dear to my heart. I tell people, you know, if I go someplace and they're giving a presentation and they do their, the little movie that they have, I just warn people at the table that I will start crying, because it's just, like I say, near and dear to my heart. But I never, it was a goal for me to volunteer out there, but with how busy I am, I never got a chance to do that. A few years ago, I was approached about being on the board, and so I spent a couple of years on the board and trying to at least volunteer in that way. And I'm not on the actual board at this point, but I'm on a board that gives advice if they need it. So it's very worthwhile cause. I did give lessons when I was growing up, and I did have a student that had cerebral palsy that I taught. I wasn't certified at that point. I'm not sure if they had programs like that, and so it just is something that I think is so worthwhile, and animals have just meant so much to me in my life and my sanity that I can see how they touch people's lives and in ways that we just don't always expect, and how many good things can come out of a relationship with an animal.
Well, thank you, Tina. We really appreciate it. And we'll potentially open up for questions at the end, so stick around, you may have more. But with that, probably ought to move on to Jim Sims and what he has to say to us today. So Jim, take it away.
Well, thank you, Michael. Hello, everyone. first thing, it was good to hear about Miss Swanson's journey and some of her lived experiences. So I think I learned a little bit more about her, and that was a good thing. And I also want to wish everyone well and pray that you all stay safe. When Mr. Shermis or Michael asked me to do something about his story insights, and we'll call this the professional journey of Jim Sims, I didn't quite know what he wanted, but I do know we believe the same things, and particularly with lived experiences and the makeup of people. I believe each of us are blessed with certain gifts, talents, and abilities. We just got to figure a way to bring them out. Now, my professional journey seems to have followed the roadmap that is with serving with and leading others along the path of community service, social justice, and civil rights. It's also to help provide a voice for the underserved, the underrepresented, and the more vulnerable populations. Now, when I was younger and maturing, in hindsight, there were many people who helped me, mentored me, and supported my efforts along the way. Also in hindsight, there were many of those people who seemed to see something in me that I did not necessarily. As Mr. Shermis states, our professional journeys start with what has shaped us. I think we'll get started. I will be as brief as I can. Michael has warned me that he is not hesitant to use the hook that they use in the Apollo Theater should I get too long-winded. So I'll try and be brief. I think where we're going to end up with today is where I am today in my journey of life so far, and that is sitting on city council and being a contributing member here with this Rotary Club. But let's go back to the beginning. Michael, you have number one. Who was that cute fella up there? When we were young, and first of all, it was clear to us that we were living along the poverty line. So we didn't have a whole lot of resources. But one of my youngest leadership, assignments, if you will, was to be in charge of my two younger brothers. There was three of us, and we were raised by my grandmother. So that is probably the toughest job I've ever had, is being responsible for two younger brothers who would rather fight and argue than to help keep us all out of trouble. I was also involved in church when I was young, and I still am a believer in God and the principles of Christianity. I think that's helped along the way and helped molding who I am. Now, this picture that's before us, that was me earning my Eagle Scout Award, and that's my grandmother who raised me. I want you to notice the sash with all those badges. They're required 21 badges to earn Eagle Scout Award, and one of the things I'm most proud of is that I hand sewn every one of those badges on that sash, and they are still attached firmly to this day. But being an Eagle Scout or along the scouting path, we had things such as the Scout Law and the Scout Oath. And in the Scout Oath, one of those things was to help other people at all times. And we also had to have an Eagle Service Project, which I did to help the Methodist Church that sponsored our troop. So I think early on in the beginning, I was kind of indoctrinated with a seed of serving and helping others. Along the way, Jim Christiana was our troop master, and he was an offensive tackle for the Ball State Cardinals football team. But he had gotten his master's in social work and took a liking to a lot of us scouts. Part of our scout troop, I will add, about a third of them were members of the Delaware County Children's Home, which was an orphanage at that time. So another bit of experience from my life. As we move on, and we can go on to my educational experience. Thank you. Thank you, Michael. That picture down there is Phi Beta Sigma. That is my fraternity when I'm here at Indiana University. Many of you will remember the names of Dr. Jimmy Ross or Dr. Joseph Russell. Now, they were both Phi Beta Sigma members and one of the biggest influencing with me in joining that organization. there's history there between the Interfraternity Council and the Panhellenic Council, but that is a conversation for another day. But my leadership pathway through there is after we became a member, then I was immediately elected as president of the chapter on campus. Now our motto, Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated, our motto is culture for service and service for humanity. And that was one of the better times in my life. We were able to do a lot of things as young college students trying to help the community be better. Now, as we, well, one thing I would like to, can we go to number three, Michael, please? Thank you. I'll get into some of my employment pathways and community service. Early on in my career here in Bloomington, I was in restaurant management. I had the pleasure of managing, that was the timer, thank you. Had the pleasure of managing a Taco Bell when there was only one in town, right next to the old Greyhound bus station. I worked at a Hardee's for a while as an assistant manager, but one of the most enjoyable that I found in the past was I managed a Pizza Hut that was owned by Mr. John Bender of the Bender Lumber family. And he introduced me to the Taskmasters or Toastmasters organization, which was very valuable to me. I learned a lot about public speaking and gaining the confidence to hold more public conversations. From a community standpoint, I was also the president of Monroe County NAACP. I was able to use some of my skills again to broaden our influence by collaborating with other organizations throughout the community. One of the ways that we first met Mr. Aaron Davis, and we'll talk about that a little bit later, I think. And I do community things like I was this past campaign, I'm sorry, capital campaign chair for this past year at the Monroe County United Way. That is a position and you do what you can, but I wouldn't have been near as effective without Efrat Pfefferman and her staff at the United Way. It's very hard for anyone to have great influence by their own. They must do it mainly as a team. Also, we've done a lot of things in the community over the last 35 years. On campus, I was a member of the IU Black Faculty and Staff Caucus. In the city, a board member the member of the Board of Public Safety. I was fortunate enough to be on the founding Board of Commissioners for the community or the Commission on the Status of Black Males when it was formed with Mayor Fernandez. So we helped form the IU Group Students Alumni Association, and many of you will recognize and know Dr. William Wiggins and his wife Janice Wiggins. So those are folks that influenced us along the way in order to help the community as best as we can. And I will also say, along with NAACP, we're still active. We will continue to work. I'm proud to let everyone know that I am a life member of that organization. Next slide, please, Michael. This will be fairly brief. It is an obligatory photograph of my wife and my family. And Doris has been, many of you know Doris. We've been married about 41 years. But she was a great example from a public service standpoint. And early on in my career is when I got to notice other public servants, such as Miss Charlotte Zitlow, such as others, because I didn't want to participate, but Doris made it clear early on that you, in order to change locally, you need to be involved locally. And that means to be involved in the community, to be more compassionate. 30 some years ago, she instilled that in me and it is still working to this day. And I am grateful for that. Lastly, if we have the picture, Michael. I think this is where we will culminate today. As a member of the Bloomington City Council, at large member, I never ever thought at the beginning that politics was in my future, at least certainly not elected office in politics. We worked hard and we did a lot of community service with a lot of organizations, built a lot of relations and collaborations with people throughout the community. And that led to, in 2017, one of my dear friends and mentors, Tim Mayer, decided to retire. And I was caucused in 2017 to finish his term. There was 2.5 years left on there. Some of the folks, the mentors, again, you need help to bring some of those skills and abilities and desires forward. Mark Fraley, those of you who know him, Tim Mayer himself, were great leaders in talking with me and mentoring me. I remember having some pretty good conversations with Charlotte Zietlow along those times too, and I am much appreciative of those things. And then in 2020, for the 2020 term, in November of 2019, I was reelected to serve 4 more years as Bloomington City Council. Now, one of the highlights, and we'll have many during this term, but on last week we offered, and it was passed unanimously, a city resolution condemning and denouncing white supremacy and white nationalism from the standpoint of local government here in Bloomington, Indiana. Also along this path, and I would be remiss not to mention my involvement with Rotary and this club. I was pleased to be asked, and I enjoy serving on the Rotary board. One of the highlights of my life up to this point is to be announced as a Paul Harris Fellow for this club. So to finish up, my life has been a lengthy journey, and I believe one's development is crafted not in a vacuum, but when one is immersed in the waters of interacting with diverse humans and humanitarians working toward like goals. My innate abilities and goals, I'd like to think, have become more refined along this journey. Working with so many fellow community members and our common goals has helped me gain deeper compassion, develop much better listening skills, and respect for the various lived experiences of others. Thank you all, and God bless. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Jim. Yeah. Well, I don't know if we have time for questions, Aaron, but I'll turn it over to you, and you can decide that, and we can always ask questions of Jim after we have closed.
Well, we have time for a couple of questions and brief responses.
Jim, I have a question for you.
Yes.
Help you. So you announced that you thought there might be a marijuana clinic opening in Bloomington. Any update on that?
The update is I am so glad you have a great sense of humor. But the kind of the butt of that joke is that that was a Bloomington, Illinois city council and local government that were authorizing, which is legal in Illinois, a marijuana clinic.
I'm glad you made that clear.
Yes, it'd be hard to get that to go through in Bloomington, and not so sure I'd be in favor.
I couldn't help but think, since my husband's also from Muncie, that the both of you came from Muncie and ended up in Bloomington, and we're glad you're here.
Thank you. Sometimes we'd say we want to change things, but I wouldn't change in hindsight along the way. I did have a little academic visit to Purdue during high school. And I ended up coming to Indiana University mainly because they offer more financial aid. yes, I think fate has led us here, in particular to be a member and friend to all of you all. That's a good way to move forward.
Jim, what have you learned so far from your city council experience?
Well, I learned that you really, really have to listen. I think you have to learn to disagree without being disagreeable. And I think there is an art of influence, for lack of a better term. I think you must be able to keep your position and share your position with my fellow colleagues. We all know it takes 5 votes to make something go. So you, many cases, have to work with others in order to attain your goals.
Jim, where did you meet Doris?
Here on Indiana University campus. I am from Muncie, and she is from Evansville. And we came here in the Group Student Services Support Program in 1975. So, yeah, that's when we met. Started dating for a couple of years, and we lived together for a couple of years, and we've been married for 41 now.
So that was lucky for all of us, too.
No more so than me.
I'd like to start wrapping up, but we can come back after we close the meeting and still have okay. some
can I just say discussion. Can I say one yes. thing? Well, one of the things that I've always promoted is partnership and collaboration. And I mentioned earlier that I believe the first time we met, Aaron, is during my presidency of the NAACP as a reach out. And we are now an organizational member of Rotary. I am involved, and I just want to go back and again, maybe it's fate, but thank Aaron for reaching out and being such a good friend and mentor as we move forward. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim and Tina. Very impressive.
Yes, we're lucky.
Yes. In honor of today's celebration of service, we'll provide this quarter's local charity donation to Centerstone, the United Way agency. And now Ashley will tell us about next week's program.
Our next celebration of service will be May 19th, right here on Zoom. And our program will be John Armstrong speaking about Pigasus Pictures, a community-based approach to filmmaking in Indiana, introduced by our very own President-elect Sally Gaskell.
Good.
Thank you, Ashley. Now for my thought of the week. And I do want people from the Bloomington Rotary Foundation to stay around also, because we'll have a little wrap up and then the foundation meeting will happen. But thought of the week, people will forget what you said. People will forget what you did, hopefully. But people will never forget how you made them feel. And that's from Maya Angelou. So please join me for the four-way test.
Of the things
we say and do.
Ellen, okay. Of the things we think,
say and do.
First is truth.
Second is it fair
to all concerned.
Third, goodwill,
better friendships. Will it be beneficial
to all concerned?
And fifth, is it fun?
Thank you all. Thanks, Michael.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Hi, Jim.
It was great.
Any other questions? Do we have any other follow-up questions?
Away there.
Aaron, this is Raj.
Hi, Raj.
I was very pleased to see how the meeting went through today, starting with the Muslim young man talking about his Ramadan, speaking with our veterinarian and her growing up and specialty in animal care, and finally with Jim. I was truly impressed. Thank you for making this program so successful in my mind. Second thing, I've been in medicine since 1959, and the more you live, the more you learn. And today, first, I have a medical appointment was done by video. While I'm sitting in my house here, my doctor is speaking to me from her Duke campus, and we conducted business.
Wonderful.
Thank you again, and have a wonderful week.
Thank you, Raj. It's great to see you.
Thank you.
Thank you.